And thanks for the introduction. The IoT is growing to trillions of devices, and today most of these devices come equipped with a battery. As we've already heard in previous talks, batteries are today seen as the single greatest threat to the vision of a truly pervasive IoT. If we manage to replace the batteries by capacitors, we can build tiny, cheap devices that can be operated maintenance-free for decades. However, this creates some problems with the execution on the devices themselves. What you see here is the typical intermittent execution pattern of a battery-less sensor node while it is harvesting energy. Initially, the device is switched off and harvest energy, increasing the capacitor voltage until it reaches a turn-on threshold. Then the node quickly executes a task with a specific energy demand, draining the capacitor until it drops below a turn-off threshold, and the node is powered off again. Despite these challenges, we've seen quite some progress in enabling computation on these devices. And this will lead to more and more of the tiny battery-less nodes being deployed. Managing every single of these trillions of devices is infeasible. Instead, we will have to make sure that the devices do cooperate and form swarms that allow users to interact with them as if they were one device, potentially even exploiting redundancy or energy diversity in order to increase the availability of the overall system. However, in order to cooperate, the devices will first need to learn how to communicate. And this turns out to be very challenging. Let's have a look at two of those devices. Adding a second node here, we see that although the nodes receive pretty similar amounts of energy, they are never active at the same time. And in contrast to traditional battery-powered systems, it's not easy to just make them wake up at the same time, because they may just not have enough energy in order to wake up at the agreed time. Clearly, the ability to wake up and communicate depends on spatiotemporal energy availability. And in order to address that problem, we first need a tool that allows us to, one, understand spatiotemporal energy availability. When do which devices have how much energy? When can they wake up at the same time? Are there correlations? Can we maybe predict energy across time and space in order to make better predictions? Once we have an understanding of the energy availability, we can start to develop methods and protocols in order to enable efficient communication between the battery-less nodes. Then, once we got these methods, we want to experiment with them. For example, we may want to compare two different protocols against a fixed known baseline by emulating realistic conditions that we have previously recorded. Or we may also want to replay, for example, model-generated traces in order to explore certain directions in the design space. When I started my PhD in 2018, we were looking for a tool that would allow us to do so. What we found is that existing tools can be categorized according to two criteria. Some tools support energy harvesting, others have no support of energy harvesting, and there are tools focused more on a single node, and others that work with multiple nodes. For example, there's Echo, which was presented here at SenSys a couple of years ago. Echo allows to record and emulate energy traces, but it is fundamentally limited to a single node only. On the other hand, there are the large testbeds that we know from the wireless sensor network research, like FlockLab or Twist. They have great support for experiments with multiple nodes, but they have no notion of energy harvesting whatsoever. What we need is a tool that allows us to do energy harvesting with multiple nodes. And this is where Shepard comes in. Shepard is a distributed instrument that allows us to experiment with energy traces across time and space. Shepard is based on an architecture consisting of multiple Shepard nodes. Each Shepard node corresponds to one IoT device that would be deployed in an energy environment. All the Shepard nodes are time synchronized with each other and have access to a common database in order to store and retrieve data. Shepard works in two key modes. The first one is recording. During recording, the observer measures the voltage and current from a harvester and timestamps the data and sends the energy traces to a database. at the database, the data from multiple nodes can be merged and analyzed on a common time scale because it is all timestamped with respect to the same synchronized time. For emulation, the process is reversed, and we can stream energy data from the database to the individual shepherd nodes. On the observer, we have an emulator that is able to reproduce the voltage and current that the node would be experiencing if it would be harvesting the energy from our trace. While we are replaying and the sensor node is running an application, the observer is able to measure the voltage and current consumption of the sensor node and also track the application state via UART messages and GPIO pin tracing. Again, this data can be timestamped and analyzed on a common time scale across all nodes. So this gives us insights into the collective behavior of all nodes while we are emulating spatiotemporal energy availability. Let's have a quick look at the implementation. Our observer is based on a BeagleBone single board computer that runs Linux and is mainly responsible for the time synchronization and for data processing. On top of that, we stack the Shepherd Cape, which contains the custom hardware, the analog measurement front end, the emulators, and those things. Users may want to experiment with different technologies, so we didn't just want to support, for example, solar energy harvesting, as you can see here, but we wanted users to be able to attach their own harvesting hardware. We did this by separating the actual harvesting hardware from the main Shepherd Cape, in order to allow to easily swap these. What you see here is our solar capelet, and we also currently have support for a kinetic energy harvesting capelet that allows to experiment with a piezoelectric transducer for kinetic energy harvesting. That's for the recording part. Now for emulation, we also need a way to connect the sensor node to Shepherd. And as the battery-less domain is pretty new, it frequently requires to use your own custom hardware and build your own circuits. Therefore, we need a way for users to attach their own hardware to Shepherd. We do this by implementing the so-called target capelets that also stack on top of the Shepherd cape. They provide a well-defined interface to Shepherd. For example, we have level-translated GPIO and UART. We have, of course, the capacitor buffer supply voltage. And we also support remote programming and debugging so that we can easily flash an application to all nodes for emulation. What you see here is our reference implementation for a target capelet that hosts the NRF52840. So far we've seen the implementation of a single node, but of course the interesting part about Shepherd is that we have multiple nodes. The most critical technical component for that is the time synchronization. Here we offer two ways to synchronize a number of observers to each other. The first one is PTP, the Precision Time Protocol, which works over Ethernet. A couple of nodes can just automatically select the leader and all of the nodes can then synchronize their local clocks to the one of the master. This works pretty well, but the problem is that you need a wired connection between the nodes. And if you imagine, you may want to also do experiments with mobile nodes or nodes that are really far apart if you think about LP1 WAN networks. Therefore, we offer a second way to synchronize Shepherd nodes. For example, if we now add a GPS reference clock, all the observers will be synchronized to global absolute GPS time. This allows us now to add any other node which without a wired connection, and as long as it is also GPS synchronized, we have a global synchronized network and can record data across nodes that may be kilometers apart or even in different countries, theoretically, if that makes sense. Let's look at some numbers that we achieved with this setup. By using a high-performance analog-digital converter, we got a current resolution in the non-ampere range and voltage resolution in the microvolt range. What is a lot more critical is the dynamic range where we are facing the measurement noise. We got down to 1.4 microamps here at our full sampling rate of 100 kilohertz and about 44 microvolts. If you're happy to compromise a bit on the effective sampling rate, because that's quite high currently, we can get well below 1 microamp as well. We also evaluated the synchronization error by comparing the times that samples, that the individual ADC samples were taken at two different shepherd nodes. We found that it's approximately normally distributed with a standard deviation of only 600 nanoseconds. What does this mean in practice? Let's have a look at an example what you can do with shepherd. For this experiment, we placed 3 shepherd nodes that are equipped with small solar panels on a table in an office room. The nodes were receiving just a little bit of light through a glass door, and the room lights were switched off in the beginning. We started the experiment, and after around 30 seconds, we switched on the room lights. Oh, I lost the presenter. After around 30 seconds, we switched on the room lights. Let's first look at an individual node. So this is the harvesting voltage and harvesting current on one node. What you would notice is that the harvesting voltage remained constant throughout the experiment, more or less. This is because the onboard DC-DC converter just regulates the voltage to a certain level. The 2 spikes are caused by the internal maximum power point tracking algorithm. The current is quite low at the beginning of the experiment, and then once we switch on the lights, which is indicated by the black dashed line here, the current immediately jumps to 100 microamps. Now this is just one node, maybe not so exciting. Let's look what the other nodes were doing. What we notice is that there's a significant difference already in this simple experiment where the nodes were really close by. We already see that, for example, node 2 here in orange received a lot more power. This is due to its it was being tilted slightly towards the glass door, so it received a little bit more light even when the lights were switched off. And then, as you can see, once the lights are being switched on, we see the sharp rise of current on all 3 nodes. Now, this was looking at things on a pretty long time scale. In fact, Shepherd allows you to record for minutes, hours, or even days. It just depends how much storage you add to the system. But the really interesting part is, of course, that we can now zoom in to the microsecond level to see what's really going on. Let's have a closer look at the area marked in red here when the lights were switched on. At this resolution, you see a lot more of what's happening on a detailed level. So the sawtooth that we see there is a result of the DC-DC converter hysteresis regulating the input voltage of the solar panel. And in the current, you can now see that even at this resolution, there's a really, really sharp edge on all 3 nodes resulting from the lights being switched on. The small dip that we see after the lights are switched on, basically there's like a step function. It's probably a result of the individual light bulbs switching on slightly after each other. So that was about the recording part. Let's have a look at the second part, which is the emulation. So for emulation, as we previously discussed, we reversed the process. So in this case, we streamed the data that we've previously recorded and that I've just shown to 3 shepherd nodes. The shepherd nodes are equipped with our target platelets, and the NRF52s were running a simple battery-less application. It was basically a sense and send task where the devices wait until they have enough energy, sends a temperature sensor, and then transmit that value over a BLE radio on 3 BLE advertisement channels. For this application, we used a capacitor of 150 microfarad. So let's look at one node again. What we see is that even while the lights were switched off, the node was able to harvest energy. So on the top you see the capacitor voltage, and in the middle that's the node current consumption, and on the bottom at this resolution it's not super easy to read, but that's the application state that we got from fine-grained GPIO traces. What we see is that the capacitor voltage is still rising while the device is powered off and the lights are still switched off. Once we reach the turn-on threshold at around 24 seconds, the device powers on and we see a spike in the current consumption and a drop in the capacitor voltage. And then the device starts to sample its own supply voltage in order to wait until it reaches 3 volts. However, as we see here, it actually starts to decharge the capacitor. This is because even that waiting for 3 volts on the capacitor just drains more, like it consumes more energy than what we can currently harvest. So we're draining the capacitor again until we hit the turn-off threshold, the device switches off, and we see the pattern from the beginning start until we switch on the lights. Then immediately we see the slope changing and the device quickly powering up again. Then a small dip when the device powers on. This is the same that we've already experienced at around 24 seconds. And then finally the device is able to reach the capacitor voltage of 3 volts and starts to execute that SenSys task periodically. Let's add the other two devices. What we see here is that node 2, if you remember, node 2 was the one that was slightly tilted towards the glass door, and we see that it's also able to charge the capacitor a lot quicker. So here you can see like this corresponding of harvesting traces to node execution. And what we also see is that all three nodes, like once the tower is there, all three nodes start to execute. Even node 3, it takes a bit longer, it seems to receive less energy than the other two nodes, but eventually it also starts to execute the SenSys task. Let's have a look at the time when even the last node starts to send the first packets. So this is again zooming in dramatically to view things on a micro scale. And as you see here, that should remind you of the figure that we had in the intro. So the devices, although they receive very, very similar energy, wake up at different times, and they would not have been able to execute the task all like aligned with each other. So in this example, there was no, like, we didn't have the goal that the devices would communicate with each other, but you see where this is going and why we need a tool in order to get these kind of insights. Here you actually see the individual packets, which are the red stripes here, that's the three packets. That you get, you can easily view how they are being sent at this time resolution. And you can also see the individual current spikes from the radio being put in RX and TX mode. That was a pretty simple experiment that should just give you an idea of what's possible with Shepherd. If you're interested in seeing how exactly we did the experiment, how the user interface looks like, please visit our demo Wednesday morning. In summary, we believe that Shepherd is a tool that enables exciting new research. It is completely open source hardened software. And even if you're not working with energy harvesting, I don't believe there's another framework that will allow you to build a portable testbed in your home that gives you this kind of like direct interaction with the hardware itself. So the existing testbeds, this may have an advantage as well, but they are always deployed at a remote location, so you can't just attach your own sensor node. And this is something that you can build in your lab. It's cheap, it's easy to build. So yeah, it allows to do pretty cool things, and I hope some of you already got an idea what they might want to do with it. So thank you, that was it from my side. Please ask any questions.